Chicago, one of America's most popular cities, as it covers 234,000 square miles, and there are hundreds of secrets and mysteries held on its premise. We've already explored the forgotten tunnels, L lines, and waterworks, but did you ever wonder what might be hiding in plain sight? Well, several buildings in Chicago's downtown area, the Loop, appear to be normal at a distance, complete with windows and doors, or even decorated in a stylish construction. However, upon closer inspection, one finds that the doors do not open, and the windows are not windows at all. Instead, they are lures. This is the story of Chicago's fake buildings. I'm your host, Ryan Socash, and you're watching It's History. Today, we will discuss the so-called fake buildings of Chicago, structures necessary to conceal vital power grid elements. And with all the news we hear about climate change, this is a topic bound to rise some emotions. That is why I'm proud to announce that this video is brought to you by Wren, a website that offers a simple and effective way to calculate your carbon footprint so that you can create a strategy to offset the damage. And you won't believe what a convenient solution it is. First, you answer a short questionnaire to discover your current carbon footprint, and then you can make a monthly contribution which Wren will use to fund different projects around the world. A few of the noble projects they support include tree planting, mineral weathering, and rainforest protection, but the list goes on. Wren is incredibly transparent regarding their projects and will send you periodical emails with details on the projects you choose to back up. Whether it's showing you photos of trees your money helped plant or detailing accounts of the project's development, you'll know exactly where your money is going. So use the link in the description to sign up for Wren. The first 100 people who sign up will have 10 extra trees planted in their name. And now, back to the fake buildings of Chicago. In short, these buildings house electrical substations built to provide power to the downtown Chicago area discreetly, a topic we've actually covered in our video about New York's secret substations. However, the history behind the Chicago buildings are far more interesting. These utility buildings are the culmination of electrical progress in Chicago, dating back as far as the late 1870s. 1878 saw Chicago's first demonstration of the arc light, which generated a continuous spark across two carbon rods, emitting light equal to approximately 2,000 candles. Arc lights easily lit the streets and other public spaces, but were unsuitable for homes and shops. Though in 1880, a man stepped forward with a solution. Thomas A. Edison and his incandescent light bulb finally brought domestic electrical lighting into a state of commercial practicality. Producing a flameless light in the fire-safe container provided a perfect lighting source for the electrical age. These new light sources, along with street railways and the developing rapid transit cars, or even L trains, significantly increased the city's electrical consumption. 1878 also marked the beginning of the so-called Battle of the Systems, a time of great technological and political conflict. With the electrical industry suddenly revolutionizing, there was an enormous demand for energy in the area. And initially, these demands were met by one of Illinois' primary economic activities, coal mining. The 1880s saw coal production at the Central Braidwood Mines at its absolute peak. However, it also saw its mining company C&W and its workers at their most dire point of conflict yet. Tensions between the miners, primarily Scottish immigrants, and the company had reached a boiling point, extreme enough to make national headlines. Ever since the creation of the mines, the miners built workers' associations, eventually climaxing in a brief miners' strike in 1868. Tensions continued, and in 1874, another uptick of conflict occurred during a nationwide economic downturn, putting a quarter of the miners out of work. At this point, C&W brought the Pinkerton National Detective Agency of Chicago in as a private security force as they hired replacement workers. The Pinkertons were notorious during the time for their highly ruthless approach to strikes and protests. often pacifying resistance with violence. The Pinkertons and Illinois troops fought against the workers as they rose up, losing in 1877, 1889, and 1894. However, by the 1900s, coal production started to drop. The most easily accessible deposits had been drained dry, and mining activity steadily declined after that. By 1892, the decline had reduced coal production to a fifth of what it was in the decade before in the Will County mines. This was highly problematic, as energy consumption only grew. In 1882, the Western Edison Light Company began operation in Chicago. It rebranded to Chicago Edison Company in 1887, and in 1892, a significant figure in public utilities took the lead of the company. As the president of Chicago Edison, Samuel Insull, once Edison's secretary, rapidly began monopolizing the city's central electrical services, consolidating the Commonwealth Electric Light and Power Company under the new corporate title of the Commonwealth Edison Company. Insull's low rates and marketing schemes undercut his competition, allowing him to secure an exclusive franchise with Chicago, making the Commonwealth Edison Company the only company operating within the city. By securing the state commission, the Commonwealth Edison Company gained favor with the governor. When Chicago's gas companies fell into hard times during World War I, Insull applied low rates, brought technological advancements, and consolidated the city's network into one. By 1920, generators of the Commonwealth Edison Company consumed more than 2 million tons of coal every year. The generators at Fifth Street and West 22nd on Crawford Avenue and the Sanitary Canal generated the most energy for the company's plants. Employing 6,000 people, the company served around 500,000 people, reaching annual revenues of $400 million. After leading efforts to connect Texas and the Midwest via a gas pipeline in the late 1920s, things would sour significantly for Insull. The stock market crashed, wiping away most of his funds, leaving him bankrupt, in fact, and so he fled the country. Though the Commonwealth Edison Company did not exactly survive the Depression, it eventually became a leader in nuclear power. As the city's power grid took shape and developed, its physical structure also fully came into form. It starts with the power plant, which generates the power that runs the grid. The energy runs into power lines, taking it wherever it needs to go. But before it gets there, it visits a substation, transforming the energy into quantities that local power outlets can use. Substations in suburban environments today are pretty small, basically being a telephone pole suspended cylinder called a transformer. Since the transformers are generally stepping the energy down into similar levels, it can get away with being small. However, a simple transformer is insufficient with something like the Chicago downtown area, which powers the 8L train lines, and hence an entire substation is needed. A complete substation is not exactly an eye-pleasing sight. At best, it's an ominous-looking box with many mechanical protrusions. At worst, it's a complex of towers that look as deadly as they are. Neither option is very scenic, and in a location as dense as the Chicago Loop, there aren't exactly places for them. Yet with the energy demands, they are completely non-negotiable. So the city needed another answer. And the previously mentioned Sam Insull had a solution all the way back in 1899. The Commonwealth Edison substation on the near north side was the first substation constructed in Chicago, and it blended right in with the city. This substation worked wonderfully, disguising the gritty machines of electrical equipment behind a facade of a typical building. Insull bought out more buildings to convert them into substations as the power grid expanded. By 1901, construction began on new buildings with the sole purpose of housing substations. These fake buildings had doors that did not open and windows covered in shutters. However, the buildings were otherwise works of art, built in Art Deco, classical revival style. And one in the River North area was constructed similarly to a Georgian mansion. The 1910s saw many of the most beautiful of these substations come about. Various architects lent their designs to these projects, including Halliburton Root, Rutan, and Coolidge. One especially notable architect was Herman Van Holst, who owned Van Hulst and Fife. His firm, an independent practice, designed most of the substations built from the 1910s to the 1930s. They constructed most of their buildings in a unique take on the Perry School of Style, unseen anywhere else in the city. But despite the artistry, the buildings were primarily made out of durable materials to house the heavy electric equipment that made up the substations. Regardless of the location or purpose of the substation, whether they were serving a neighborhood, a streetcar system, or an L train line, they had both flair and functionality. Some of the antiquated sites were refurbished or repurposed for modern use, but construction did continue, some as recent as the 1990s, and surprisingly, their artistry has not decreased. If anything, the focus on the aesthetic has seemed to increase. That's not to suggest that the older ones don't hold up. It's just surprising when you consider how degenerate most modern architecture can be when compared to the times of the old. So now that we have our history lesson settled, let's have a look at what's left of Chicago's fake buildings. First up is 6155 South Prairie Avenue. Construction on the Washington Park substation began in 1928 and ended in 1939. Well, it currently sits empty and abandoned. Its electrical equipment remains. Compared to most of the other substations, it is a massive building since it served a large neighborhood with smaller substations to which it distributed energy. Its ornaments resemble electrical equipment, with light bulbs carved into its limestone facade. It currently faces demolition by neglect. But there is a small glimmer of hope as preservation movements wish to refurbish it. Next up is the Commonwealth Edison substation at 119 North Dearborn Street. This one, designed by Halliburton Root in an Art Deco style and constructed in 1931, is defined by its enormous black doorway topped with a carving of a man bearing lightning bolts, hinting at its purpose. The limestone building is small compared to its neighboring steel, glass, and concrete structures, but it once fit in seamlessly with those around it at the time of its construction. Another substation with a great deal of history is the Well Street Terminal substation. Located at 321 South Franklin Street, the building opened alongside the 5th Avenue Terminal, which opened on October the 3rd, 1904. It was less of an art piece underneath the tracks than the station itself, as not to draw attention away from the building it existed to serve. But much like the station, it had Gerber architectural flourishes. While the terminal no longer exists today, the substation remains, serving the Loop L long after its parent building's demolition in August of 1964. The AT&T Equipment Building at 10 South Canal Street is another building designed by Halliburton Root. Unlike the others we have spoken of previously, this building opened in 1970 and is 23 stories tall. The doors at the bottom are functional and the top 7 floors contain actual windows, though the other 18 floors contain the electrical equipment and as a result are windowless. In place of windows, grooved concrete pallets fill the windowsills. To some degree, this building may be a product of the nuclear fears of the 1960s. The building obviously wouldn't survive a direct blast, but its walls would protect the equipment and people from a nearby detonation. The telephone services it provides would be invaluable in the event of a war, so structural integrity was paramount at the time of its creation. Allegedly, the building also hides an oil tank with a 1 million gallon capacity, turbine generators, and a water well, allowing it to operate for over 2 weeks without any outside contact. But again, let me emphasize, this is just speculation. Lastly, one of the most recent buildings is the Enwave chiller plant at 137 South State Street. Constructed in 1995 using designs of Eckenhoff Saunders Architects, one of its primary purposes is to inspire curiosity about its interior. The building has a CVS pharmacy at the bottom, but it's topped with 4 near windowless floors. The building contains ice and water tanks in nearly all of its hidden areas for various purposes. Massive fans and cooling towers lay at its top, designed to preserve the cold that makes the water more efficient. You see, the water that this building contains supplies the entirety of the loop with coolant, condenser water, chilled water, so on and so forth. These strange buildings dot Chicago's downtown area, fitting in perfectly with neighboring structures. And only with a curious eye will you ever notice just how out of place they really are. Which begs the question, what other mysteries does the Windy City contain? Chicagoans, let me know in the comments section below and perhaps I will make a video on your topic. Otherwise, support the channel by subscribing, share our Chicago history playlist, and check out our video about New York's fake buildings. This is Ryan Socash, signing off.